Hi, everybody. I'm Brittany Lewis with Forbes Breaking News. Joining me now is Congresswoman Harriet Hageman. Congresswoman, thank you so much for joining me.
Well, it's wonderful to be with you again.
It is wonderful to have you, but this weekend was really sobering. It was really harrowing. Former President Donald Trump survived an assassination attempt during a political rally in Pennsylvania. What is your reaction to the whole situation?
Well, I'm absolutely stunned, and I'm incredibly angry. I'm incredibly angry that we are at this point in time where there are people who believe that that is the solution to the political discourse that we're having. And I'm angry for a lot of reasons. As we were talking before we went on air, the last time that we were confronted with this as a nation was in 1981 when Ronald Reagan. And I still remember that day extremely vivid. I was in school, and I was in shop class, and I'll never forget the moment that our teacher came running out where we were working. I think, and came running out and said that the president had been shot, and it was just a stunning circumstance. And I had some of the feelings on the day when I learned that Trump had been shot. I am so angry at the fact that we are demonizing. That there are people among us who are demonizing their political enemies to the point where you take somebody like this young man, this 20-year-old, probably believed that he would be a hero about Donald Trump. That is absolutely on the, and the rhetoric and the likening him to Hitler, and that if he's elected, it's going to be the Third Reich, and he's a, none of that's true. We'll have to stop saying it.
I want to first talk about, how do you think this happened? Because since the shooter was outside of the perimeter of the event, does this fall on local law enforcement? Were there massive security issues from Secret Service? I mean, what questions do you have here?
So I think that there are a lot of questions that need to be answered. And I am glad that Jamie Comer, the chairman of the Oversight Committee, will be starting hearings a week from next Monday when we return to Congress, when we return to Washington, D.C. I don't know where the failures came in, or if it were that there was a failure on a variety of levels. I did hear that there was a local law enforcement person who was aware that he was on the roof, attempted to go up there. The guy turned around, pointed his gun at him, and then immediately, when the guy went back down the ladder, he immediately turned around and shot at President Trump. So if that is the case, someone was aware that he was there, and we just need to get to the bottom of it. I'm not going to speculate as to what happened or where the failures may be. There's a lot of questions that need to be asked. Is hiring the best qualified people, physicians. It's just too incredibly important not to make sure that we have the most people. We got to get away with this idea that diversity is our strength. I know the new head of Secret Service said that she's got these goals. She's going to hire a number of Native Americans and a certain number of women and a certain number of LGBTQ. I don't care. With security, those kinds of attributes are entirely relevant to me. All I care about is whether they're the best qualified, and we need to get back to that.
When you go into these investigations, you know, what specific questions are you going to be asking? Because right now, a lot of people have questions for the head of Secret Service, Kimberly Cheadle.
Well, again, I want to know that we are not reducing or lowering our standards because we are pursuing this equity and inclusion type of mantra and agenda. I want to make sure that we're hiring the best qualified people to protect our president, our vice presidents, and other members of the political class, I guess you would say. So the question I have is, making sure that we're hiring the best qualified people. They have enough hands, are they? Were they shorthanded for some reason? What was that? Did they have any kind of pre-information about whether there was going to be something like this happening? I think all of those questions need to be asked and answered.
So we don't know much about the suspected shooter, but here's what we do know. His name was Thomas Matthew Crooks. He was a registered Republican who did give a small donation to a Democratic-leaning group. And in the wake of the shooting, Republicans have criticized Democrats for their central messaging be that Donald Trump is a threat to democracy. What do you make of all of this information that's coming out, A, and that blame on Democrats?
Sure. One of the other questions that I think needs to be asked is, what kind of medications was this young man taking? Was he on prescription medication? Was he on antipsychotics? Was he on... I believe that anytime we have events like this, whether it is some kind of a mass shooting or a terrorist act or this kind of a situation, we're going to have to start getting to the bottom of what kind of meds these people are on. The other question that I think is absolutely legitimate for Republicans as Democrats for their rhetoric. They have been escalating it and escalating it and escalating it. And what I mean by that is, just this last week, there was a magazine that had Donald Trump on the cover as Adolf Hitler. I'm going to say this again, and I'm going to keep repeating this. Donald Trump is not Adolf Hitler. There is only one Hitler. There is only one Third Reich. There is only one government that was like the Nazis during the Second World War and prior to when it started. When we equate people to Hitler, I think we are inviting this kind of action, because I would bet that this kid perhaps thought that he was going to be a hero by taking out what the Democrats are describing as a Hitler. That's one of the problems. But the other problem is that when we equate a disagreement in politics, a disagreement in governing, I am a conservative. That doesn't make me a fascist. In fact, it's just the opposite. I believe in limited government. I believe in liberty. I believe in freedom. I believe in responsibility. I don't want the government telling me what to do, what car I can drive, where I can go, how I can travel, what I can eat, and how I can heat my home. Yet that's exactly what the Democrats do. But they turn around and they claim that Donald Trump is Adolf Hitler, and that if you're a conservative, you're a fascist. And then you turn around and you have people like this who tried to kill Donald Trump. The Democrats and their rhetoric are to blame for the escalation of this kind of political situation in our country. They need to knock it off. But in addition to that, equating Donald Trump or myself or any other conservative or Republican to a fascist or being like Hitler completely downplays what happened with Hitler and the Third Reich. Hitler was an evil man who killed over 6 million Jews. And just because I believe in limited government, or Donald Trump believes in limited government, wait, it's crazy, but it completely downplays what happened with Hitler and World War II. So people need to knock that off. That magazine should be forced out of business tomorrow for putting that picture on the cover and having an article that electing Donald Trump is going to be like electing the Third Reich in the United States of America. It's ridiculous.
Congresswoman, it is no secret that we are currently in a highly politicized, highly partisan time. The temperature really seems to be at an all-time high right now. And this weekend was a really terrifying example of political violence. So there have been calls for unity from both sides of the aisle. So what's your message to your constituents and to Americans, regardless of party?
Look at the form of government that we have and recognize that the reason we have had this Constitution in 248 years, and the reason that our constitutional republic has thrived, is that foundational document, the Constitution. What it does in terms of separation of powers, what it does in terms of limiting the power of the government as per the individual, our First Amendment rights, our Second Amendment rights, our Fourth Amendment rights, our Fifth Amendment rights to equal protection and due process. We have the legal framework in place. We have the political framework in place to last for another 250 years or more. But people have to understand that it's that foundational theory, that foundational, I guess you'd say, mores that we have in this country that have allowed us to thrive the way that we have. And I'm going to say the Democrats will tear that down. They want a fundamentally different form of government. And we have seen, we saw it with Barack Obama, and we're seeing it in spades with Joe Biden. They want to be able to tell us what kind of a car we can drive. They want to take away our freedoms. They want to limit what we can consume in terms of food. They want to restrict our ability to travel. They want to turn us into a lot of the 50 states around the world. As long as we have the constitutional foundation and we adhere to it, that is ensure that we are adhering to the rule of law, equal protection. As long as we're to that constitution, we'll not only survive this, but we will thrive. I agree that the rhetoric is way too hot, but you know, when I walk back and forth between my office and the Capitol, I'm not being confronted by organs screaming in my face about how bad Israel is, or how we cannot continue to give money to Israel. I'm confronted by the pro-Hamas people. Those are the kinds of people where the rhetoric is getting completely out of control, and they're not aligned with the Democrats.
Then how do you think that it will be turned down? I mean, what do you think the solution is? I want to read part of President Biden's statement to the nation. He said this, he talked about, quote, the need for us to lower the temperature in our politics and to remember, while we may disagree, we are not enemies. We're neighbors, we're friends, co-workers, citizens, and most importantly, we are fellow Americans and we must stand together. So what do you think the solution is here?
I think he needs to apologize for the fake was in front of the red and black backdrop that he did a year ago, where he screamed at us and screamed at Republicans and screamed about MAGA extremists. I think he needs to apologize for that speech and say it was a terrible mistake. I think he needs to apologize for standing in front of us in the well of the House of Representatives during his State of the Union address earlier this year, where he screamed at us. He was like a deranged old man yelling at us about how extreme we are and how we're going to take away everybody's rights if we're elected. I mean, you've got an extreme party in the Democrats right now in terms of what their policies and what their philosophy is. I think if he wants, he really does need to tone things down, but he's been a large part of the problem. I'm not going to apologize. I think that I'm not saying that this is equal on both sides, because it's not. I know a lot of people want to say, well, both sides need to calm things down a bit. I'm not going to do both sides are to blame here, because that's not the circumstance. The Republicans are not taking this approach. We don't call the Democrats the Nazis and Hitler and put Joe Biden on the front of a magazine, equating him to that, despite the fact that what he did a year ago was a pretty frightening backdrop and message that he gave to the American people. It had nothing to do with unity. And right now, the rhetoric we're getting from the Democrats has escalated this situation, where we almost had our front runner and the former president of the United States assassinated.
I hear you that you're not both sizing this issue. Do you think then President Biden, he is A, the president, B, the top of the Democrats' ticket, do you think he's to blame here for what transpired Friday or Saturday?
What happened on Saturday was a deranged young man who took a rifle up on top of a building and attempted to assassinate the Republican frontrunner and the former president of the United States. When we're talking about rhetoric and the messaging, then I am going to place the blame on where I believe that it belongs. And again, that is with the Democrats, and that is with Joe Biden. But at the same time, one person took a shot on Saturday. But when we're talking about when you have the president of the United States equating his opponent to Hitler and saying if he is elected, he is going to do what Hitler did, you can see why some deranged would perhaps do what this young man did. That's all that I am saying. That's why I think that it is absolutely horrific. I have said for years and years and years, whoever invokes Hitler first will always lose the argument, because there is only one Hitler. There's only one. And anybody who uses that imagery, anybody who attempts to equate their political opponents with someone of that level of evil, they themselves are engaging in rhetoric that really should have no place in our form of government.
Congresswoman, obviously before the RNC, before Saturday, no one could imagine the events that happened on Saturday unfold, the attempted assassination of a former president, the head of the Republican Party. You're currently in Milwaukee right now at the RNC. What is the mood there?
People are excited. People are excited about the convention. People are excited about President Trump. We're excited to learn about who his VP pick is. This was a tragic event that happened on Saturday, most specifically for that hero, that wonderful man who lost his life and other people who were injured. And we simply cannot forget them. And my heart just absolutely breaks for them. They went to something that they were excited about. They wanted to be there. They wanted to see the president, and it changed their life forever. And in many ways, it changed all of our lives forever. At the same time, we have to move forward. We have to be able to move forward. We're going to be nominating hopefully the next president of the United States on Thursday evening. There's a lot of excitement in the air. People are very upset. People are very hurt. People are very emotional about what happened on Saturday. Yet at the same time, we're very resilient. And I think that President Trump has been just absolutely masterful in his messaging, in his show of strength, in his willingness to fight and continue to fight, and his message to all of us to keep fighting for America. A very strong America First attitude, a very strong sense of optimism here. Obviously, if things had gone differently on Saturday, it would be utterly devastating. But it didn't. God's hand was in that crowd that day. And as a result, our candidate survived, and it wasn't worse. And so there's a lot of excitement surrounding what's going on in Milwaukee right now.
Congresswoman, I always appreciate our conversations. Thank you so much for coming back on. You're welcome anytime.
Thank you.